चलो सर, ये लाइव हो गया। ठीक है,
आपने देखा है भाई?
नहीं ना, सीन अलग अलग बने दीदा है, ब्रॉडकास्टिंग सीन। देखा
अच्छा लीज देखा है चैनल मोड में देखा है
है, चैनल मोड देखा है। अतियाना सीन में नहीं, हवे तो अतियानो खेली है कि ना
ना ना वांदो ले
कान हवे फिर भी ये तो देखे। ये सर ने क्या चाहिए?
अच्छा अभी
अभी आपको जब बोलना स्टार्ट करना है तब ये सीन शुरू करना है
या फिर बैठे रहे जाइए मत सर ना मोबाइल में देख लो, मारा मोबाइल में देख लो, मारा मोबाइल नहीं है
आले लो
बोला व्हाट्सएप बंद है। एक मिनट
सर ना, सर क्या है यहां पर सर? 11:30 को स्टार्ट करना है, 11:30 को ऑप्शन करना है, उसकी जरूरत नहीं है, उसको छोड़ दीजिए।
अच्छा ठीक है,
या कोई नहीं बोलोगे
वो चैट में वो लिखेंगे क्वेश्चन, आपको दिखाई देगा, आपको आंसर देना है तो दे सकते हो।
और सीन टू में मेरा फोटो आ जाएगा ना? गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल ऑफ यू, माई नेम इज़ सुब्रत पाल, आई एम असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर एट द मारवाड़ी यूनिवर्सिटी एसोसिएटेड विद डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ फिजिक्स एज वेल एज डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ केमिस्ट्री। टुडे आई विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट द स्टैटिस्टिकल मैकेनिक्स एंड इट्स एप्लीकेशन इन बायोलॉजी। सो आई वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू टू दिस वेबिनार। इफ यू हैव एनी क्वेश्चन सो यू कैन पुट इट इन द चैट एंड आई विल ट्राई टू आंसर आफ्टर द वेबिनार। Or also you can drop me an email. So my email is subrata.pal@marwariuniversity.edu.in. Okay, so as you can see, the title of the webinar is Statistical Mechanics and its Application in biology. So in this webinar I will be covering the following things. I will talk about the basic statistical mechanics, which some of you may have studied in your BSc or MSc. Then I will go to little bit higher, which is related to time correlation function, and then the application of biology using statistical mechanics, where I will be talking about the Leventhal paradox and protein folding, modeling of biomolecule, molecular dynamic simulation, and at the end, computer-aided drug discovery. So, first of all, what is statistical mechanics? Statistical mechanics, as all of we know, is a branch of physics. Not only that, it is the backbone of the theoretical physics. And who are the people, those who are using statistical mechanics? Statistical mechanics are mainly used by physicists, theoretical physicists, theoretical physical chemist, as well as biologist. So how does it work? It works on the concept of microstate and macrostate. So it depends on the situation, depends on the system. So each and every system having lot of microstate, and combination of microstate gives you macrostate. So the behavior, what we are measuring, is a macroscopic property. That property is coming from the microscopic property. And in statistical mechanics, we use the probability theory. and probability theory, where we will take the microstate which is more probable, will give rise to the thermodynamic property, and finally sorry for inconvenience, here we are talking about the microstate and macrostates. So here we are first starting with the microstate. So what do we mean by microstate? Microstate is defined as the state of the system by the constituent particle. For in quantum mechanics or classical mechanics, what we do, say I have n number of particle. So in this case we are defining the particle by its position and momenta. So there will be n number of position and n number of momenta. But as we know, the position is a three-dimensional variable and momenta also three-dimensional variable. So total there will be six-dimensional variable. So hence, if I having n number of particle, then I will be having 6n variable. So if I consider a space which is six-dimensional space, then one dot in the six-dimensional space will give me the microstate, and this space is called your phase space, which you have studied already. Those who are in BSc lower semester, maybe semester 1 or semester 2, they will be studying statistical mechanics in the next semester. Now, what do we get? We get the macroscopic property, for example, temperature, volume, energy, entropy, enthalpy. These are the measurable quantity. So this measurable quantity are the macroscopic property, and these properties are coming from the microscopic property. So hence there is a bottom line, is that is all the microstates are available? No, microstates are accessible if its properties are consistent with the specific macrostate. See, this is a very important concept. You have n number of microstates. Can all the microstates are accessible? No, all the microstates are not accessible. Theoretically, there is a possibility, lot of number of microstates, but the microstate which is accessible is only those which is consistent with the properties of the macrostates. So now let me give you a simple example which will help you to understand what is the meaning of microstate and macrostate. Say I have six ball. Very simple example to understand the microstate and macrostate. Say I have six ball which you have to distribute among the three boxes, box numbered as A, B, C. And condition is that there should not be any box empty. So there are some distributions shown in the figure. So where you can see, the first one, the combination is 2, 1, 3. Second one, 1, 3, 2. Third one also 1, 3, 2. Fourth one also 1, 3, 2. Hence, the point is that these are the different microstate. But when we talk about the macrostate, if you compare between 2 and 3, the distribution is 1, 3, 2, 1, 3, 2. Hence, both the states, 2, 3, even 4, they will give rise to the same macrostate. Whereas, if I look into the individual state, we will see the number of the particle or number of the ball are different. So, hence, they are different microstates giving rise to the same macrostate. So, hence, the macrostate is the overall property. What overall property we are looking for? We are looking for 1, 3, 2. So, number 2, 3, 4, all are having 1, 3, 4, 1, 3, oh sorry, 1, 3, 2 combination for 2, 3, 4. They are representing the same macrostate, whereas the individually, if I look into that, the number of the balls are different. So, hence, they are giving you the different microstates. Moving forward, this is the one of the game that we play. Even during the lockdown, we are playing with our friends, with our kids, that which is called tic-tac-toe. So you have 9 boxes where you have to put the cross and zero. And if you are getting alignment of all the cross diagonally or horizontally or vertically, you will win these games. So look at the center figure, where you see the 9 boxes are there, so many combination, cross and zero combinations are there. So each combination will give rise to a microstate. So microstate is the combination of the particles. So now question is that, having understood the microstate, can we extend it the same concept in biology? Yes. So this is an example of your ligand receptor binding. So we are having so many ligand and we are having a receptor. So if you see microstate 1, 2, 3, 4, depending on the concentration of the ligand, your distribution of the ligand will be different. So hence you will see the different microstate in biology. This way you can also correlate microstate in biology also. Now, one of the important thing, why these microstates are important? How do I correlate the microstate with the macrostate? See, the number of microstate or number of possible number of microstate is related with the property. See, if the number of possible microstate is less, that means your system is well ordered. It means that entropy of the system is less. So let us try to find out the number of microstate. So it is given by this formula LCR, where L is the ligand and R is the receptor. In the previous example, it can be anything. So since in the previous example we see the ligand and the receptor, so here the number of ligand is more and receptor is less. So that's why what we are taking L out of L ligand, how many receptors are there? So you will be having LCR, which is combination rule, and if I extend it, it will be factorial L divided by factorial R, L minus R factorial. Now why this is important? It is very much important because this will give you the number of possible way that your microstate can have. And hence what happened, the logarithm of this quantity is related with the entropy of the system. This is one of the breakthrough work done by the scientist Boltzmann. So S equal to K ln omega, or sometimes this omega is written as W also, which is called weight of the configuration. So hence you see the number of microstates are very important to understand the macroscopic property. Here entropy is the macroscopic property. So now we are coming into different statistics. Why this is required? Say we are having microscopic state, macro state, and particle are going to occupy the state. Now what is the nature of the particle? There are two things. First, you have to see, can you distinguish between two particles or not? If your particles are distinguishable, that means I can separate out, this is the number one particle, this is the number two particle, then by default they will follow the Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics. If you are not able to identify the particle, they are not distinguishable. In reality, sometimes what happened, twins, we sometimes looking at the twins, they are so identical, we cannot find who is who. So under this situation, what we will be calling as, they are indistinguishable particle. So if you are having distinguishable particle, by default it is Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics they will follow. In case if you are having indistinguishable particle, then what will happen, they will follow either Bose-Einstein or Fermi-Dirac statistics. Now question is that whether it will be Bose-Einstein or Fermi-Dirac, that will be decided by the integral spin or half integral spin of the particle. If the particle is having half integral spin, then what will happen, you will have Fermi-Dirac statistics for this particle. If it is integral or zero spin, then they will having Bose-Einstein statistics for this particle. There are example, generally all the gas molecules obey the Maxwell-Boltzmann statistics. Photon, phonon and all meson. Meson are the one kind of fundamental particles you will see in the nuclear physics. So they obey the Bose-Einstein statistics, and the most commonly used, your electron, proton and neutron, they are the half integral particle, and that's why they will follow the Fermi-Dirac statistics. There are other properties also, I am not going to discussing, just to distinguish the particle which statistics they are going to follow. So you can have thumb rule, is distinguishable by default Maxwell-Boltzmann, indistinguishable either Bose-Einstein or Fermi-Dirac. If half integral, then Bose-Einstein. If integral, then sorry, if half integral spin, then Fermi-Dirac statistics. If the integral spin, then Bose-Einstein statistics. So now we are going into the another concept which is used in statistical mechanics, which is called ensemble. Ensemble is what? Ensemble is collection of large number of systems which are macroscopically identical but microscopically different. If you remember the ball picture where number 2, 3 and 4, 3 state, I just going back to that picture. So where this picture is important, if you see 2, 3, 4, this all the 3 combination are having same macro state but different micro state. So combination of these 3 will give you an ensemble. So hence ensemble, while defining the ensemble, ensemble is the collection of large number of systems which are macroscopically identical but microscopically different. So and there should be one condition applied to the collection of the system. Based on the condition, you will be categorizing them in a different name. For example, microcanonical ensemble, canonical ensemble, grand canonical ensemble, isothermal isobaric ensemble, and isoenthalpic isobaric ensemble. So these are the 5 different ensemble which are available in the statistical mechanics. But the bold one, first 3 one, microcanonical ensemble, canonical ensemble, and grand canonical ensemble, these 3 are mostly used. Among these first 3, the canonical ensemble is the ensemble which is widely used. Now, question is that, what are the variable in the ensemble or what is the constraint? Constraint means the condition which is being applied. See, here I am showing you 5 ensemble comparison. First one, microcanonical ensemble, where we say NVE, sometimes it is called NVE ensemble, number of particle, volume and energy should be constant, they should not change. So that's why it is a system of insulator. That means it is called closed system, sorry, it is isolated system. So if you have, you might have studied different system in thermodynamics, one is called isolated, one is called closed, one is called open. So microcanonical ensemble referred to your isolated state. Then canonical ensemble. Canonical ensemble, what are the constraints over there? Here, number of particle, volume and temperature. These 3 things cannot change. But what can do? You can have the exchange of energy. So hence, here your energy exchange is possible. This belongs to a closed system. And grand canonical ensemble, where chemical potential, volume and temperature remain constant. So hence it belongs to an open system. There are other 2 systems which is called your Gibbs ensemble or isobaric isothermal, which is NPT, number of particle, pressure, temperature remain constant. And last one is your enthalpy or isobaric isoenthalpic ensemble, where your variable are number of particles should not change, pressure should not change, and total energy of the system should not change. So hence it is the isolated system. There are isolation which is shown in the picture. So this is the comparison, or this is the 3, this is the 5 different ensemble that are available. Now out of 5 ensemble, as I told, the first 3 are most commonly used, and out of this first 3, the canonical ensemble is widely used. Now there is a concept in statistical mechanics, partition function. Those who have studied the quantum mechanics, they are familiar with the wave function. So what wave function gives the properties of the system in classical mechanics, and partition function describes the statistical properties of a system. So they are very similar. So if you know the partition function generally variable of depends on pressure, temperature and volume. These are the state variable. And if you know the partition function, you can calculate almost all the thermodynamical variable. In comparison with the wave function in quantum mechanics, if you see, if you have wave function, then what happened, wave function, you know the operator concept. So know the operator and the wave function, you will get all the parameter in quantum mechanics. Similarly here, if you know the partition function, and then everything in your hand. But if you remember, I tried to correlate with the different parameter. Wave function, if you remember very carefully, wave function is sometime having dimension. Those who have studied quantum mechanics in particle 1D box, remember, particle in 1D box, this is the first problem students solve when they learn the quantum mechanics. And the wave function, what you will get, under root 2 by L sin n pi x by L. So remember, under root 2 by L, so your wave function is having a dimension of L to the power minus half. But in this case, your partition function is not having any dimension. But partition has another property, which is something like that. Say your system is having translational, rotation, vibrational, degree of freedom. Then what you can do, you can calculate the separate partition function. Partition function separate for the translation, separate for the rotation, separate for the vibration. And if you multiply all, then you will get the total partition function. And as I told, partition function is a dimensionless. Sometimes it comes in net question also about the partition function, about the dimensionality. So moving forward, what is the mathematical definition of partition function? So it is nothing but the summation over all the energy Ei by kT. If the energy are discrete, but if your energy is continuous, we know that summation is replaced by integration. And here Ei by kT in the left hand side and right hand side, we are having Hamiltonian of the system. Hamiltonian gives you the total energy of the system, and then you have to integrate over the phase space. dQp and dQv, dQq, Q is the coordinate and p is the momentum. So it is mathematical jugglery, don't worry about that. This is mathematical definition. The important thing is that what are the things that we can get out of the partition function if it is in my hand. You see, everything is available. You can calculate the average energy, pressure, entropy, Helmholtz free energy, chemical potential. That means all the thermodynamical parameter of your system can be calculated from your partition function. That's why partition function is very, very important. So now moving forward, understand the partition function thermodynamical property. So we are going into the another formulation, that is formulation of time correlation function. Now, what is time correlation function and why it is required? Say somebody is asking question. So you are a theoretician. How do you correlate with the experimental result with theory? Is there any correlation, any relation, or it is totally separate? Theory is theory, experiment is experiment. No bridging between the theory and experiment. Yes, I can bridge, and the statistical mechanics can help you to bridge the experimental result and the theoretical result by the time correlation function. So time correlation function, I will tell little bit about the time correlation function, and then I will directly go over to the application of time correlation function, and where we will see how your experimental result which we obtain can be correlated with the theoretical result. So time correlation function, I will just briefly discuss. Say I have a variable A and B. They are dynamical variable. Dynamical variable means variable which changes with time. And I want to see how variable A at a time depends on variable B at another times. So it is represented by this equation, something like this: A t and B t plus tau. T plus tau means another time, and t is another time. And they are giving an angular bracket. This angular bracket is the ensemble average. That means you have to take the average over the particle as well as average over the time. Now, if I have both variable is same, say A and B are same, then this time correlation function is going to be called time autocorrelation function. This time autocorrelation function is one of the things which can correlate the theory and experiment. So now, in this case, what you will be doing, we will take you some example which is in biology. Because my aim to relate the theory and experiment. So I am not talking about the properties of time correlation function. I am going to directly application of your time correlation function to get the different property. Now in the screen, what you are observing DNA, another protein molecule, another lipid bilayer, which are in solution. So there will be water molecule around the biomolecules, protein, DNA or lipid bilayer. My question is that property of the whole water molecule in the DNA solution or protein solution or lipid bilayer across the biomolecule is same, because we want to see the dynamics or we want to see the property of water molecule. So say in a region where water molecule is having some confinement, in a region where water molecule is having little bit free, so how do I know that this region where water molecule is less mobile, in another region water molecule is more mobile? So what I can do, I can calculate a quantity which is called velocity time autocorrelation function. That means what I will do, I will tag or I will note down the velocity of the water molecule at different time in different region, and finally I will calculate the velocity autocorrelation function and I will integrate it to get the diffusion coefficient. Those who are not familiar with the time correlation function, I have given little bit introduction to the time correlation function, but here just to let you know how the experimental quantity and theoretical quantity can be correlated. So in this case, what you are correlating the diffusion coefficient, which is experimentally measurable. And by knowing the diffusion coefficient and comparing with the normal water diffusion coefficient, if the diffusion coefficient that you are calculating is less, then you will conclude that your water molecule is less mobile in that region. So that's how you can correlate with the mobility of the water molecule in biological system. So let's move forward with another example. This is neutron scattering in biological system. So neutron scattering experiment is widely used for the biological system to determine the atomic structure. Why in the case of biological system? Because biological molecule are made up of the atoms which are having less atomic number, and that will give rise to the high cross-sectional area for the neutrons to interact. So now you might have heard about that SANS, small angle neutron scattering. These are the techniques that is used to calculate the structure of the molecule. Now in the experiment, what is the measurable quantity? The measurable quantity is your structure factor at a given wave number. So wave number is denoted by Q. So you are calculating the wave number and finally you are predicting the structure. So now theoretically, how do you calculate? Here also similarly, you are having the position of the particle or position of the nucleus that you are tagging and calculating this kind of time correlation function. This time correlation function directly give you the structure factor which is experimentally available. So hence you can predict the structure knowing the position of the particle at a given wave number. So you see, you can correlate with the neutron scattering result from the theory. So again, there are so many things. I am going to discuss one more thing, which is infrared spectroscopy, IR. Left and right chemist and biologist, they are taking the infrared spectroscopy to get the structure of the molecule. And what are the different functional groups are associated, because different functional group gives you peak at a particular wave number. So hence, the molecule what you are studying experimentally, you will take the IR spectrum and you will associate some functional group which is associated with the molecule. Now question is that if I have the molecule, how do I calculate theoretically the similar information? So as you know, the time correlation function formalism can help you out in this case. So what you will do, you will calculate the dipole moment. I repeat, dipole moment of the molecule at a different time, and you will calculate the dipole moment time correlation function and take the Fourier transform of that, this will give you the exactly IR spectrum, FTIR, Fourier transform infrared spectroscopy. So hence, you see the things people are doing left and right in experiment are correlated with the theoretical value, and these are only correlated by the time correlation function which is coming from the statistical mechanics. So moving forward, I have lot of example, dielectric relaxation. So you know that dielectric relaxation is associated with the absorption of energy, and dielectric relaxation is having two part. One is called your real part and another is called imaginary part. So dielectric loss is associated with the imaginary part of the dielectric constant, and if you see a protein solution, you will see lot of dispersion. These are beta delta beta dispersion, delta dispersion, gamma dispersion. So this dispersion are having special significance. Now if I having theoretical model or theoretical system, how do I calculate the spectrum, dielectric spectrum? What you can do, you can calculate moment, not dipole moment. Remember, moment is different, dipole moment is different. So moment time correlation function is related to the dielectric constant of the system as a function of your frequency. See, here time correlation formalism is very, very important. So it can help you, it can correlate you with the theory and with the experiment. So it is not like that ki theory is totally uncorrelated with the experiment. Your statistical mechanics is there to help you out. So now even spin relaxation in NMR, people are calculating T1, T2, spin relaxation time. There are two different time, T1 and T2. Those who are familiar with the NMR, they are very much aware of what is T1 and T2. I am not going to discuss about this thing, but this relaxation time T1 and T2, you can also calculate from the time correlation function. This time correlation function, only you should know what variable I should choose. The variable in this case is the angular momentum time correlation function. So in this case, what will happen, you should identify the variable. That is very much important, which variable you should identify to correlate the property of the experimentally observed quantity with the theoretical one. So now there is one more thing, which is diffusion coefficient or rotational diffusion coefficient. Now why do we need rotational diffusion coefficient? It is important for the protein, whether your protein is globular or non-globular, that means spherical or non-spherical. If you are having spherical, then your diffusion coefficient is well defined. If it is away from the spherical shape, non-globular, then your rotational diffusion constant will be different. So hence, you can calculate the, or you can comment on the shape of the protein by calculating the rotational diffusion constant. How do I calculate rotational diffusion constant? It is calculated with the help of time correlation function. And what is the variable in time correlation function? The variable is your angular velocity. So if you calculate the angular velocity about the center of mass of your system, so you are tagging or you are calculating angular velocity of your system about the center of mass at a different time, and you are calculating the time correlation function that is going to be related to the diffusion, rotational diffusion constant of the biomolecule, and it will tell you whether the biomolecule is in spherical shape or non-spherical, I mean to say globular and non-globular. So these are the things where you can have the application of statistical mechanics in biology also. Next one is one of the very important techniques, which is called solvation dynamics. Solvation dynamics gives you the local information, means you are having a protein, and protein is nothing but it is the combination of so many amino acids, and it is generally solvated in water. In our body, it is solvated in water. That means around the protein, so many water molecules are there. So now if you want to see how these solvent molecules are responding to the external disturbance, what you do, you send a laser pulse. to be more precise, you send a femtosecond laser pulse. So what will happen once you are sending the laser pulse, in this case you see this blue one is representing the biomolecule, maybe protein, maybe DNA, whatever it is. So in this case what will happen, you are just sending the femtosecond laser pulse, it will create a dipole moment in the molecule. So once the dipole moment created in the molecule will be in the excited state and it will de-excite by releasing the energy to the surrounding molecule. And as a result, if you want to study the emission spectrum from the molecule, you will see the emission spectrum will get red shifted. That means slowly, slowly its frequency will decrease. And you will come to know about the solvent response of your disturbance. So theoretically and experimentally this can be done. First I will talk about the experimentally people what does. People calculate a solvent response function which is denoted by ST. And what is that? It is the emission frequency at time t with the emission frequency at time infinity. Infinity means after a sufficient long time, which we say steady state emission. And they define in this manner ki how your response function is going to be. And when we talk about the similar thing, we do a calculation, we calculate the energy of the system and fluctuation. Here important thing, fluctuation is very much important. So your energy fluctuation time correlation function is related with the ST. One is called CT, another is called ST. But thing is that it is under certain condition. Condition is what? Condition, you should not go away from the equilibrium. You may be very near to the equilibrium, it is okay. That's why it is called within the linear response. Sometimes we say Hooke's law. Within the Hooke's limit, your stress and strain are proportional. So similarly, in this case, if you are exciting the system, disturbing the system, but you should not go far away from the equilibrium. So hence, under this situation, you can calculate the CT, which will correlate with the observation. In the figure, you see there is a graph showing which is the theoretically calculated graph. You see different time scale is mentioned in the graph. So if it is of the order of some few picosecond, so you will say it is the bulk water kind of thing. If you getting a response in the of the order of picosecond to 20 picosecond, what you will say, it will see the water molecule which is confined. And then if you are having in the region 20 to some nanosecond, what will happen, it will give rise to the contribution from the ions. And if the getting very long response, though, it will be from the ion atmosphere. So different region are being categorized looking at the response function. So hence you can tell whether in this region, whether you are having only water molecule or it is the combination of water and ion or only ion, these all three things can be calculated from the this response function. So you see how nicely your statistical mechanics is related with the biological system. Almost some of the properties which are calculated from the experimentally, you can correlate with the biology also. So moving forward, we are talking about a very interesting thing, protein folding. Now what is protein folding? So protein folding is a process. You have synthesized a protein, because in our body lot of proteins are being synthesized and they should go a particular state or particular structure which is called native structure. If it is not native structure, the protein will not function or it will misfunction. That means it will function in a wrong way. So the protein folding is very, very important for the protein to fold in its native state to function properly. And there is a paradox which is called Leventhal paradox. Question is that how fast protein can go into its native state, because you are having protein which is nothing but your combination of amino acids. So if your combination is amino acid is there, so there are so many possible of combination which we talk about the microstate. So you are having different microstate. So out of which microstate is the corresponds to the native state, it is very difficult to calculate, but protein does it very fast. So if I explain you the Lewenthal paradox in a short form, it will be something like that. So I am taking a 100 residue protein. That means I am having 100 amino acid. It's a small protein. 100 amino acid protein means it is a small protein. That means amino acid are connected by polypeptide bond. So you are having 99 bond, because 100 one after another if you write, then you will be having 99 bond. And if you are having 99 bond, then there will be 99 into 2, 198, phi and psi angle. Those who are not know phi and psi angle, it is related with the Ramachandran plot, one of the Indian scientists who has given this phi psi plot for the protein, and world respect him for his work. This was a breakthrough work for him. And whenever there is a protein structure is mentioned, there should be a phi psi plot. Being an Indian, we should feel proud for him. And also he is from Indian Institute of Science, from where I belong, so I feel more proud that I am his alumni. Now, thing is that we are having 198 phi psi. Now, the total number of state possible, it will be 3 into 198. Why this number is 3 is coming? Okay, I will not discuss at this point. Just assume that it will be 3 into 198. So, these many states are possible for the 100 residue protein. Now, question is that if I start sampling out of this many state, one of the state is my native state. But how do I know this is my native state? So what you will be doing, you will be just sampling that one. And the sampling, if you do 10 raised to 12 sample per second, I repeat, 10 raised to 12 sample per second, then also the time required is, which is going to be the larger than the age of the universe. See, the problem is here. You are having so many configurations, and you are sampling so fast, 10 raised to 12 sample per second, then also the time which will get the time required to sample so many state is corresponds to the larger than the age of the universe. Then how it is possible for protein to fold in its native space within a few nanosecond, picosecond, at the maximum millisecond? It is doesn't go beyond millisecond. Then there is a huge contradiction, huge conflict about this time. This is called your Lewenthal paradox. And finally, this problem was solved by the physicist, to be more precise, people associate with the computational physics, and they calculated different state and the probability using statistical mechanics extensively, and finally they solved this protein folding problem. And one of the scientists associated with this is Martin Karplas, David Leavitt. They were awarded for their work, Nobel Prize they were awarded just for computational work. So that's why computational field is very, very important. And computational field means it is direct application of statistical mechanics. So now, going forward, what they did, they proposed the folding funnel. Folding funnel means I have a state, one state. When I explore the second state, if it is having higher energy, I want to explore it. I will go to the lower energy. And so, slowly, slowly, if you see the possible number of state, but it will go down energetically, and finally it will come to the bottom of the funnel, which is corresponds to its native state. So many things I am talking about, but you may not be aware of so many things, but my point is to just to let you know where statistical mechanics can be applicable. So now we are talking about the modeling of biomolecule. See, when we are trying to give some measurement, we need to model the biomolecule, because we are theoretician. So why biomolecules are required? Because there are so many interesting things, and depends on your interest, how you are thinking, what you want to measure. It is not possible to measure everything, depends on your interest. For example, I have a DNA molecule. And what I will look for, it can be considered as a simple sequence of nucleic acid, ATGC. So there is, I can think about the simple sequence. If it is my interest, I want to study the sequence. Some will see that drug is coming and binding to the DNA. So his interest is through drug binding. So you will see the DNA as a binding site. As you know that DNA is having negatively charged phosphorus backbone. So somebody wants to see how the charge distribution, he will consider DNA as a charge rod. Similarly, it is having elasticity also. So you can think about it is elastic rod or the random walk of the amino acids. So not amino acid, nucleic acids. So many things are associated with the DNA modeling. Depending on your nature, you will model it accordingly. So similarly, another molecule, three different biomolecules we are talking about, DNA, protein and membrane. So in case of protein, the similar thing will happen. Say, I want to study the sequence of the protein, how it is different amino acids are associated. Then I just consider protein as a combination of hydrophilic object and hydrophobic object. It is a chain where hydrophilic and hydrophobic objects are related. Then I can think about the protein is a collection of ribbon and cylinder. Also, if I think about the lattice, so I will consider the amino acid are distributed over a given lattice. And also I can study about the ligand binding process. Also, last one, I can think about the protein as a ion gate where sometimes it will keep open and sometimes it is closed. So depending on my interest, I will model the molecule accordingly. So it is not possible to model all the thing at a time and study all the property, not possible. Similarly, if I take membrane, so membrane, you can think about that it is a array of spin because it is compressible membrane. Then it is the random surfaces. Also, you can see very interestingly, you can model membrane as RC circuit. And also, as you know, that membrane sometimes allows some molecule to pass through, or sometimes it stops the molecule, doesn't allow to pass through. So you can think about the semi-permeable membrane. So here it is depends on your interest, what you want to do. So depending on that, you will model your biomolecule and study the property. Then how do I study? One of the technique is to study the molecule is through the molecular dynamic simulation. It is a computer simulation techniques that apply the movement of atom and molecule in the equilibrium state. And how do you do that? So you are calculating the different interaction which is present in the molecule. And what is the interaction? The interaction is nothing but depending on what is the nature of the molecule that is present in the system, or different atom present in the system. And what you will see, we will do the evolution of the system. Evolution means you will take the snapshot of the system as a function of time. And this function of time, the interaction or movement of the particle depends on the Newton's law of motion. Here we are talking about the classical simulation. We are not talking about the quantum simulation, which is called density functional theory, DFT. So we are talking about the classical simulation where Newton's law of motions are applied. So here what we'll do, we are calculating the different forces, and then force to the displacement of the particle. Now what kind of force that particle will phase, that will depend on the potential energy, because first derivative of potential energy is your force. So in this case, you should know very precisely what are the things you are having in your system. If you are having a charged particle, say, then you will say it's a Coulomb interaction. If there is not bonded, we'll say there is a Van der Waal interaction. So here what we'll talk about, that we'll talk about the different interaction. And who are the people use? Lot of people nowadays using this computational techniques, because it has lot of importance. First important thing is that it is very, very cost effective. It is doing, you are doing all the things in vitro. So you are doing in vitro, that is outside the cell. So in this case, what happened? Your cost is negligible, only time is associated. So now, having the understood the molecular dynamic simulation, we will see the different force field. For example, if you are having a bonded interaction, that means the molecule are connected, then you will say it is a harmonic potential, half kx square, r minus r equilibrium. If you are having angle, then also you will take the harmonic potential. If you are having dihedral angle, dihedral means angle between the two plane, then there is a specific form of the potential. These are the three things where you are having bonded interaction. Bonding means either it is connected between the two atom, or the bending motion or vibrational motion of the molecule, and dihedral, that is the angle between the two plane. So these are called the bonded interaction. Now there are non-bonded interaction also. Which is non-bonded interaction? Non-bonded interaction is nothing but the interaction which is coming due to the size of the molecule. So one of the non-bonded interaction is the van der Waal interaction. And another non-bonded interaction is the Coulomb-Coulomb interaction. Molecules are, atoms or molecules are not connected, but due to their presence of charge on their surface, they are interacting. So I am having Coulomb interaction. So these are the interaction you should know when you are modeling your system. In this case, when you are modeling, you are having biomolecule, either you take protein, DNA or membrane. Along with that, you are really having water molecule or solvent molecule. You may have counter ion. So when there are counter ion interaction, you will be having the Coulombic interaction. Say you are having the molecule interaction, so that will be going to be a bonded interaction. So you should be very careful what kind of interaction you are specifying. Because of your interaction, your force is going to be decided, and based on the force, the movement of the particle will take place. So now I am giving you a simple example, computer aided drug discovery. So in this case, there are two parts. One is called ligand based method and another is called structure based method. And there is a certain difference in ligand based method and structure based method. In structure based method, the 3D information of the target to be known. The target is known. And ligand based method, where 3D structure of the target is not known. So in this case, one case target structure is known and target structure is not known. What you will be doing? You will be doing some sort of docking. That means lock and key. So you are having lock, you don't know which key will fit. So you will try keep on different key, and one of the key will fit and you will be open the lock. So similarly, I am not going into detail, but giving you the rough idea how this can be helpful. So here is a cartoon. Say what we are talking about, it is ligand based drug discovery. So here you are having the active site. That means you know the target protein. So where your ligand will go and bind. So what you will do, you will take different ligand. They should not be random. Depending on your requirement, you will design the ligand which are very close but little bit different, and you will try with the protein. And what you will do, you will dock this ligand to the protein and calculate the so many parameters. One of the parameter is your energy of interaction, and you will find the ligand which is binding. If the interaction energy is less, that is the stable configuration, and hence you will take those target. So in this case, you will have different ligand, your target is fixed. So which ligand is going to bind to the target depending on the calculation. It is cartoon only, but when people are doing, so many things are going to be taken into consideration. So hence, what we will have this thing here, where you will calculate the entropy, energy, enthalpy, so many things. Whether sometime you will find that it is energetically favorable but entropically not favorable. So considering all those things, and all those things only calculated using the statistical mechanics. So sorry. So I would like to conclude my presentation. So what I will be talking about, what are the things we have seen? We have seen the basics of statistical mechanics and some microstate, macrostate, ensemble, partition function. And one of the important thing you might have seen maybe for the first time, where how the time correlation formalism is helping you to correlate the theoretical and experimental data. And finally, I talked about little bit about the molecular dynamic simulation and computer based drug discovery. So before saying going for goodbye, so I would like to share this slide. You might have seen, might have heard about this story where there are blind men and they have been asked to touch an elephant, and they are touching different region and they are commenting what they are feeling. So hence, in this field also, in biological field, it is a very vast field, and in this field different time scale are associated. You cannot correlate one phenomena with the another phenomena because their time correlates, time is different, time in the sense in which time scale it is happening. So in this case, if you see this picture, I like this picture very much. Several people are touching the several region of the elephant and they are commenting, it is like that. One person is touching the trunk of the elephant and then trailing, it is like a snake. And some people are touching the ear, it is like a carpet. So something like that. So in the biology, the different reaction, different phenomena takes place in different time scale. So if you want to correlate all the time scale at a time, it is not possible. So you have to be different process with different time scale. So finally, I want to say thank you to all of you for listening me, and thank you for your time. Thank you very much.